It's now time for Mark Hankins, Faith for Every Nation. Mark and Trina train and equip leaders in every nation through church services, leadership conferences, mission trips, and media. Get ready for a direct and joyful message about how to grow in your faith and learn more about who you are in Christ. Now, let's join Mark and Trina.
Hello, I'm Mark Hankins, and this is my wonderful wife, Trina, and welcome to the program today. We're going to study one of my favorite subjects. We're going to talk about who you are in Christ, or we're going to talk about identification with Christ. When we talk about identification with Christ, the dictionary actually defines identification as to make identical, or to consider or treat as one and the same. That's like if you go to the airport and you want to fly somewhere, they'll say, do you have any identification? Well, then you have to have a driver's license, or if you're going international, you have to have a passport. And that means when you hold up your passport, you're saying, this is who I am. This passport and me are identical. We are one and the same. Well, today we as believers must see our identification with Christ, or we must see who God says we are in Christ. Amen. So let me give you several scriptures and we'll look at those scriptures. One, our favorite one, is 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. It says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, everything has become new. I like to say it this way. You're such a different person in Christ. You'll have to let God introduce you to your new self. In other words, like you're that. A different person. You're not the same person you used to be. You are now who God says you are. Actually, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 says, but we are the workmanship of God, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. In other words, we're God's workmanship created in Christ. So I like to say it this way, God put into Christ everything He wanted you to be, or He deposited in Christ everything He wanted you to have, or what God's work He did in Christ. Actually, everything God did in Christ, He did it for us and is set to the credit of our account like we did it, or we were identified with Christ, or we were actually given the same identical life that God gave to Christ. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 through 6, one of our favorite verses, says, but God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love wherewith He loved us, even when we were dead in sin, He quickened. The word quickened means He made us alive together with Christ, and hath raised us up together with Him, and made us sit down together with Him in heavenly places. Actually, God gave us the same identical life that He gave to Christ. And He raised us up together with Him, and He made us sit down together with Him in heavenly places. That's where you begin as a believer. That means you're never really fighting for victory. You're always fighting from victory. That means you take your place in Christ, that you're identified with Him, and you have the same identical life, same identical righteousness, same identical blessing, and same identical authority, and same identical access, same identical victory that's in Christ. What God did in Christ, He did it for every man, and every believer now has access to everything God did in Christ. So He says, actually, you and I as believers are now in Christ. Not someday when we get to heaven. It's not some spiritual position you grow into. Right. It is the grace of God that identifies you with Christ and gives you the same identical life that He gave to Christ.
I like how you say, if any man be in Christ, he's in Christed, one translation says.
He's not in crisis.
No,
he's in Christed.
Yes.
Yeah, and so in other words, I like to say, if you're not in Christ, you are in crisis. So if any man's in Christ, then actually one writer said, you've been in Christed. Mm-hmm. In Christ, in other words, kind of made a terminology out of what happened when you made Jesus the Lord of your life. You're now in Christed. And so you're no longer in Christ-is, you're in Christ-in. In other words, everything that now is in Christ belongs to you. And the word Christ means the anointed one and his anointing. So that means you're now in Christ. And those two words, in Christ, are used by the Apostle Paul primarily, and they're used by the Apostle Paul actually 130 to 160 times in Paul's letters. In Christ, in Him, in whom, in the Lord. That phrase is actually a term that the Holy Spirit used to describe the spiritual reality that every believer has the moment you make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. God sees you in Christ. And you look a lot better in Christ than you do outside of Him. One more thing I like to say, and that is if you're not impressed with who you are in Christ, then you just have not seen Him lately. In other words, Jesus, everything that's in Christ, He says now belongs to every believer as an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ. You're a new creature in Christ. That's a part of your confession of faith.
That's right.
I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away. Everything has become new.
This is such a fantastic truth in the Word of God. Many people overlook it, and we need the help of the Holy Spirit to open up our eyes and so that we can see the fullness of what God has done. And I was thinking about the Apostle Paul. Before he was Paul, he was Saul. And God just knocked him down off of his horse with a light, bright light. And he was knocked to the ground. And when he turned and repented and he met Jesus, that was the first day he met Jesus, and he was so changed. Mm-hmm. And Jesus gave him an assignment that he would preach and teach, and the light that he spoke mm-hmm. would turn people from darkness to light. Mm-hmm. And so this gospel is a message of light
and
revelation.
Paul's conversion is in the book of Acts three times. That's mm-hmm. very unusual that in Acts chapter 9, Acts chapter 22, and Acts chapter 26, mm-hmm. this one man, how he met Jesus Christ. And actually, some theologians say Paul's letters are simply an explanation of his conversion. When he met Jesus Christ, it radically changed him. In other words, Jesus didn't just help him a little bit or just do a few little things for him. He said, I'm not the same person I used to be. Right. I'm a new creation in Christ. And so Paul's letters literally are centered around this concept of who you are, what you have now in Christ. And he literally uses that term 130 to 160 times. In other words, that's the center of what you'd call Paul's letters or Paul's revelation. That means what God did in Christ. And Paul said, I'm praying for you as a believer and for every believer. He said that God would give unto us, every believer, that God would give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of God, that the eyes of our understanding would be flooded with light, that we may know what is the hope of His calling, what is the riches of the glory of His inheritance, and what is the exceeding greatness of His power towards us who believe, according to the working of His mighty power, which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and set Him at His own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world but also in that which is to come. And He put all things under His feet and gave Him to be the head over all things to the church, which is His body, the fullness of Him that fills all in all. That means that the church or the believer, we are the body of Christ, and Christ is the head, and we are joined to Him. That means we have the same identical life and victory that's in Christ. And even if you think you're just a little toe in the body of Christ, you're still seated far above all principality and power. Victory is yours in Christ.
I remember when I first met you, Mark, you talked about in Christ all the time, and it was something that was I just started learning about, and we began to talk about praying the Ephesians prayers, mm-hmm. especially the Ephesians 1 prayer.
Yeah.
And I began to pray that. I'll never forget the first time I prayed that prayer, because I could actually feel the power of the Holy Spirit coming into me.
Yes.
And he began to open up my eyes and begin to see the word, like light shone out of it.
Yes.
And the word just came off the page, came alive to me about who we are in Christ. It's incredible.
Yeah, the prayer in Ephesians 1 was what I was just quoting, Ephesians 1:16 through the end of the chapter. Mm-hmm. And this is a prayer for every believer. In other words, when you and I as believers pray this prayer, we're saying, Father God, I'm asking you to give unto me the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of God, the eyes of my heart. In other words, he's really not asking God to do something for us.
Yes.
Really, he's saying, God, I'm asking you that you would show us that we would see who we are and what we have already in Christ Jesus. Mm-hmm. In other words, God's already done everything he's going to do about your healing, your deliverance, your victory, your blessing, your salvation in Christ. He's already done that work in the death, in the burial, in the resurrection of Christ. In other words, that's the center of who you are and what you have, your identification with Christ. Actually, Paul was not praying that we as believers would be more dedicated.
Right.
He said, I'm not praying for your dedication. I'm not praying for your consecration. I'm praying for your revelation.
Yes.
In other words,
yes,
your dedication is connected to your revelation.
Yes.
Every breakthrough in dedication comes from a breakthrough in revelation. In other words, we're changed as we see the love of Christ. We're changed as we see the power of God in Christ and what God has done for us in Christ. So he says, I'm praying that you would see. I like to say it this way, every breakthrough in faith comes from a breakthrough in revelation knowledge. In
yes,
other words, the Word of God literally is a different kind of knowledge. It's revelation knowledge. It shows you what God did for us in Christ, what God saw, what happened in the Spirit. Revelation knowledge
right,
is where faith comes from.
In that prayer, it talks about the eyes of your understanding, your heart,
mm-hmm,
will be flooded with light, the Amplified Bible says, and you know, how many Christians don't even know that you have eyes in your heart?
Yeah, the eyes
you
in
could
your heart.
Have inward eyes that could understand the Word of God, and it's God talking to you. You are a spirit. So this is a breakthrough when you understand you are a spirit,
yes, many,
made in the image of God.
We talked about this. We met at a university, a Bible college, mm-hmm, and I went 4 years, and when we met, then we would talk about the Ephesians 1 prayer. But I actually learned that from Dad Hagen or Kenneth E. Hagen. He said, if you'll pray the Ephesians 1 prayer at least once or twice a day for at least 6 months, he said, number one, the Bible will become a different book to you. Number two, you'll be changed, because revelation knowledge will begin to open up to you. The Holy Spirit will give you fresh revelation. So you're just simply your desire and your prayer, your diligence. Father God, I'm asking you, give me a spirit of wisdom and revelation. That's the number one need of every believer. Mm-hmm. And so he said, pray that. So I just wrote it down on a card and put the Amplified Bible on another card,
yeah,
and carried them in my back pocket. And
every
day,
that.
Yeah, every day we'd pull those cards out and I'd say, Father God, I'm not asking you for a new Corvette. I'm not opposed to a new Corvette. I'm not asking you for some big new TV. I'm asking you for the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of God. In other words, this spirit of wisdom and revelation helps us to see what God saw. We see, we actually get the same identical vision, or we see what God saw, we see what happened in Christ in his death and resurrection, and we find ourselves in him. In other words, we're identified with him. You'll find yourself in Christ. The moment you see yourself in Christ, mm-hmm, immediately there's victory, mm-hmm, and there's joy and there's rejoicing, because you see who you are, not who you're trying to be,
right,
not who you need to be, not who you're someday going to be, not who you're struggling to be, but you see the grace of God,
that's
what
right,
God has done for you in Christ. And we said this yesterday, that God's work in Christ far exceeds any damage done to us by Adam's fall. In other words, the moment you get to be in Christ, the blood of Jesus, the power of his resurrection, literally will undo everything Satan has done in you. Well, you could say in Adam and in you, that the old person used to be is gone. You're identified with Christ. You have a new identity. You are now who God says you are. You're not who your mama made you. You're not who your past made you. You're not who mistakes made you. You're not who your feelings make you. You are now who God says
God
you are.
Says,
in other words, if you believe that God is everything the Bible says He is, you must believe that you are everything the Bible says you are. And
Amen.
God says you're a new creature in Christ. You're the righteousness of God in Christ. So your confession of faith is simply, I am who God says I am. I have what God says I have. I am redeemed by the blood of Jesus. Christ has set me free. Sin cannot dominate me. Satan cannot dominate me. Old habits cannot dominate me. Jesus is my Lord, and I am a new creature in Christ.
And then you'll get really happy.
Yeah, then you just kind of laugh a little bit and rejoice because you're not struggling to make it happen. You're
it
not trying to get there. This is the way the grace of God is the opposite of legalism. Mm-hmm. Legalism, religion, keeps you trying and struggling, and if you are more dedicated, but the grace of God immediately identifies you with Christ and raises you up with Him and seats you together with Him in heavenly places. Amazing grace.
Amazing grace. Mark, I like how you talk about the powerful prepositions. Those prepositions, you know, a lot of times we don't know anything. Can you talk about that?
Well, actually, the two words in Christ really is only made up of Christ and the word in. And the word in is a preposition. And so many years ago, as I was studying who you are in Christ, Arthur S. Way, his translation of the New Testament in Paul's letters, actually Arthur S. Way said, the key to the gospel is in the prepositions.
Yeah.
The prepositions. He said, little words like for, with, in, through, and by are the key to the gospel. Actually, he said, but the English language was not constructed for a preposition to carry the kind of weight that the gospel calls upon it to carry. He said, so the prepositions break down under the weight and go almost unnoticed.
That's true.
I thought, that's amazing. The key to the gospel is in the prepositions, and yet many times we don't notice those prepositions.
Right.
Little words like for, with, in, through, and by that connect us to Christ and show our relationship.
So those are connecting words.
They're connecting words and show relationship.
Okay.
That means everything God did in Christ, He did it for us. One of my favorite scriptures, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12, says, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but with His own blood. He entered in once into the holy place, and He obtained eternal redemption for us. Other translations say, in our behalf. That means everything Jesus did, He did it for us, in our behalf. Because He did it for us, it is set to the credit of our account, like we did it.
So when you see that word for, you can stop there and see how we're connected.
Yeah, in our behalf.
To what Jesus did.
And it shows substitution.
Yeah, okay.
Same thing as 2 Corinthians 5:21. For He hath made Him to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. So here you have the prepositions that show substitution and now your identification with Christ and now who you are in Christ. Everything God did, He did it for us in Christ. So those two words show substitution, identification, and union with Christ. Actually, P.C. Nelson, who wrote Bible Doctrines for the whole Assemblies of God denomination, in his chapter in the original book on Bible Doctrines on the chapter of sanctification, he said, we are literally made holy by recognizing our identification with Christ in His death and resurrection and by daily reckoning upon the fact of that union with Christ. In other words, you can't produce that on your own. Jesus did that for you, and now you are in Christ or in union with Christ, and you acknowledge your identification with Christ.
So you said reckoning. What does that word mean?
Reckoning literally is an accounting term. Accountants do not make the figures, they just record the figures. In other words, you're not trying to make it so,
right.
You're just accurately recording that everything Jesus did, he did it for me. Right. So here's the reckoning. Romans 6:6, I know this, my old man, the old person I used to be, mm-hmm. my old humanity, my old self was crucified with Christ, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth I should not serve sin. So he says, now that is a fact. We know this, our old man was crucified with Christ, yeah. that the body of sin might be destroyed. Henceforth, I should not serve sin. So now he says, now reckon yourself to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God. That means you don't make that so, you just reckon or agree with that and say that's the truth or that's a fact, that I was crucified with Christ.
So if you're struggling with something, you know, lifestyle, habit or whatever, your temper or whatever, that belongs to the old creation.
Anything that belongs to the old man.
Well, what do we do then? We reckon the truth that yes. you were crucified with Christ, that yeah. old nature has died.
Yes.
So you're saying that
yeah.
and reckoning and accounting it to be a fact.
Yeah.
And as you say it, then yeah. the power of the word is renewing yeah. your soul.
Renews
and it's
your
engrafting
mind.
And being engrafted
radically
into
changes,
your mind.
You're transformed. Yeah. Actually, one writer said that mind renewal begins with identification with Christ.
Wow, that's
interesting.
Good.
In other words, to get to the root of changing the way you think.
So you're not just quoting
you're not just
positive
trying to
things
change
only.
A few positive things with
right.
your mind. You're actually getting to the root of your identity.
Ooh.
That is no longer the person you are. You are now who God says you are. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away. Everything is new.
So that's the truth that makes you free. Doesn't Romans 6:17 say something about
it? Actually, Romans 6:17, we'll have to get in that later.
Okay.
But Romans 6:17, it says Paul's system of truth, or that doctrine in which you were instructed, begins with your identification with Christ. And now, if you would just look at Galatians 2:20, Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself
praise
for me.
God.
That's
right.
powerful, isn't
it's
it?
So
in
powerful.
Other words, Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but it's no longer I that lives. It's Christ that lives in me. Paul said, I have a whole new identity.
You should lead a confession of faith.
He said, I am crucified with Christ. In other words, he said, this is who I am.
Yes.
Other translations say, I consider myself as having died, and now I'm enjoying a new existence, which is simply Jesus using my body. The Message Bible, which is good, says this, I identified myself completely with Christ. In other words, I didn't get my identity from the past or from my experience or even from my skin. I don't get it from my job. I get my identity from Jesus Christ. Yes. And on the cross, what he did for me, Paul said, we were there. Everything he did it for us. Right. One man, Adam, got us in this mess. Yeah. And one man, Jesus Christ, got us out of this mess. Jesus is the last Adam,
yes.
but he's also the new man, the new humanity. In other words, Jesus is the new, the original, first, born from the dead, the first of the new creation. And what God did in Christ belongs to every believer and belongs to you. Actually, you just simply say, yes, Lord, I believe and I receive. And the love of Christ, oh, what God has done in Christ, draws you. And you see that Jesus paid the penalty for our sin and for our past. He became everything that we were. He was made to be sin for us. When he took our sin, he took everything sin produced, the rejection, the shame, the curse, everything. When he took our sin, he took everything sin produced that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. In other words, Jesus did that for you. And when you've been made the righteousness of God in Christ, that qualifies you for the best blessings that God has. Amen. And so your confession, you should boldly
Hallelujah.
Confess that Jesus is Lord. Right now where you're at, when you say Jesus is Lord, you're saying, Satan, you cannot dominate me.
That's right.
Sin cannot dominate me. Old habits cannot dominate me. Jesus is Lord. And then Paul says, hold fast to that confession. Don't turn loose of that. It's not just your initial confession. It's a daily declaration that I am a new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away. Everything has become new. In other words, Jesus changes everything. He changes the way you see yourself. He changes the way you see others. He changes the way you see your future. The moment you make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, then pray that prayer in Ephesians 1, Father God, give me the spirit of wisdom and revelation. And then look up those scriptures on who you are in Christ and make that confession every day. I'll guarantee you things radically change by the power of the gospel of Christ. So I encourage you, find out who you are in Christ. Don't just look at it, but declare it every day. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. And if you'll boldly declare that, you'll find out truly in Christ, old things can no longer control you. You're now a new creature in Christ. And now we run out of time for today, but until next time, may God richly bless you.
You are watching Mark Hankins Ministries, Faith for Every Nation. Many Christians talk about what they are trying to be, what they need to be, and what they are going to be. Jesus did not go through the agony of crucifixion, death, burial, and resurrection just to help us a little. What happened from the cross to the throne in those 3 days changed everything. God wants you to understand who you are and what you have now in Christ. Learn who you are in Christ with the book, Taking Your Place in Christ. God is planting a whole new crop of righteousness, wisdom, redemption, sanctification, blessing, joy, and victory on the inside of you. Put on the new man by declaring who you are in Christ. In the book, Paul's System of Truth, Mark Hankins reveals man's redemption in Christ, the reality of what happened from the cross to the throne, and how it is applied for personal victory in your life through Jesus Christ. This book will revolutionize your view of who you are and what you have now in Christ. With this offer, you will also get the 4-CD set, Paul's System of Truth 2.0. When you get a revelation of your identity in Christ, Jesus' resurrection becomes not just his victory, but it becomes your victory. In the 4-CD set, Freedom in Christ, you will understand your identity is connected to your destiny. Lose your mind and get the mind of Christ. Get these messages and develop your spirit and overcome. Your generous gift of $25 or more will help Mark and Trina train pastors around the world. Order today by calling 318-767-2001 or visit markhankins.org.
The Mark Hankins Ministries app makes it easy for you to watch the latest TV broadcast, listen to the radio program, read our daily devotional, and stay connected with upcoming events. Download the app today on any smart device. Simply search Mark Hankins Ministries. Start feeding your faith anytime and anywhere.
Thank you for watching Mark Hankins Ministries, Faith for Every Nation. For more information on how to build your faith, visit markhankins.org. You can access many free word resources to help you find who you are in Christ. Stay connected with us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or our YouTube channel. Thank you for watching.